in the face of the action of the majority. Now, this is the thing that Lenin never accepted for 1 minute. He never accepted for 1 minute. And when you look at Lenin, it's very interesting. He comes to the revolutionary movement. In the 55 volumes of Lenin, there are only two references to his brother. One is the reference in which simply when he has to fill his party membership, there was a question, what about your background, your political background? So he writes, I had a brother called Alexander Ulyanov that was hanged in 1887. Then there is another place in which, in one article, he refers to the Aronniks of 1887 that were hanged, and he gives a list of the five people, including, in the fourth place, he put Alexander Ulyanov. Now, why is this terribly interesting? You say this because he was kind of nothing of the sort. He loved his father. He loved very deeply his father, but he loved the truth even more. And because he knew that the center of the arena is the working class, you'll find a whole number of quotations, a very sharp quotation from him, attacking the Naronic exactly on this issue. He says, for example, I'll give you one quotation. We must be distrustful. You remember the Naronic not only argued that the minority will be the detonator and the activist and all the rest of it, but they also argued that there is no difference really basically between workers and peasants. Because all the Russian people, the workers and the peasants, are toilers. And as toilers, they will be really the inheritors of the future of Russia. And let me start by simply saying that should be not true. We must be distrustful towards the peasantry, always organize ourselves separately from it, and be ready for a struggle against it, insofar as the peasantry shows itself to be reactionary or anti-proletarian. Again, our last advice, proletarian and semi-proletarian of city and country, organize yourself separately. Place no trust in any small proprietors, even the petty ones, even those who toil. We support the peasant movement to the end, but we must remember that it is the movement of another class, not the one that can or will accomplish the socialist revolution. Then again, he says in another quotation, the alliance between the proletariat and the peasantry must in no case be interpreted to mean a fusion of the different classes or parties of the proletariat and the peasantry. Not only fusion, but even any sort of lasting concord would be fatal for the socialist party of the working class. Now this is terribly important because this is the central theme of Lenin that repeats again and again and again, and people try to, quite often, to cover it up. This is the central theme. The working class must keep its independence. Of course, when it comes to the liberal bourgeoisie, Lenin was completely despising that. And there is a very obvious reason. If he didn't know anything about Marxism, even then he would have despised the Russian liberal bourgeoisie. Because you must simply remember that when Lenin's brother was hanged, and although Lenin belonged to the nobility, I'm sorry, perhaps it is not good for Stalinists, because the Stalinists usually, when they write a biography of Lenin, they tell you he was born to a progressive educator. Now, if he was a progressive educator, the Tsar must have been also a progressive educator, because the Tsar made him a hereditary noble. You don't get the hereditary nobility if you are a progressive noble. But the fact of the matter, that when Lenin's brother was hanged, the whole neighborhood knew that the father was a respectable, liberal, so to say, educator. His mother couldn't get anybody to take her to the station. There was nobody who was ready to offer his card to take her to the station. This is the courage of the liberal bourgeoisie in face of tyranny. Therefore, Lenin defined the liberal bourgeoisie. And towards the peasantry, he had a distrustful attitude. From the simple standpoint, he says, there are a million-headed sea of petty bourgeois capitalism growing every day. And you have tens of quotations from this, from Lenin about it. And we are a little island of communism at the midst of it. So therefore, the first thing I want to make it clear is that for Lenin, the central thing was the agency of the working class. Good. Now, if I say that this is the central thing of Lenin, then I'll have to go from there and say that the second connection with the question of the working class is the center, is the question of the interrelation between the party and the class. Now, there are a number of stories about what Lenin thought about the party and the class. There is one story that simply quotes Lenin's small but very, very important book, What is to be Done, in which Lenin says, quite simply, he says, the working class spontaneously can come only through trade union consciousness. And therefore, socialist consciousness has to be brought by the party from outside. This is a true quotation from Lenin. And therefore, there is a lot of people that come and say Leninism in this concept that the working class spontaneously comes only to trade union consciousness, and we, the party, stand somewhere up in the sky and we deliver the socialist consciousness. This is a one quotation from Lenin. Alas, they didn't read Lenin well enough. Because you'll find from Lenin, 2 years later, or 3 years later, in 1905, very different quotations. We must... I'll read you the quotation from Lenin of 1905. The working class is instinctively, spontaneously social democratic. Social democratic at that time was the name of the party. The special conditions of the proletariat in capitalist society leads to a striving of workers for socialism. A union of them with the socialist party bursts forth with spontaneous force. Workers should be, and that's why he comes to the conclusion, workers should be incorporated into the ranks of the party organizations by the hundreds of thousands. Well, in 1902, he speaks about the party being made of professional revolutionists, a tightly knit group of individuals, you know, that will keep together and bring socialist consciousness to the class. And you say, I don't understand, did Lenin say the first statement or the second statement? The truth is that Lenin said both statements. Because if the, when you speak about spontaneity and consciousness, for Lenin, spontaneity of consciousness is not a thing that one can exist without the other. There is no spontaneous action, there is no organization with it. There is no spontaneous action, there is no consciousness with it. The workers go and fight, there is some consciousness there. And there is no conscious action, that there is no spontaneity with it. Because conscious action without spontaneity is not action. And the question to which level Lenin could emphasize in what stage of another depends really basically on what the working class was at the time. In 1902, Lenin faced a very serious problem. And the problem was this. There were strikes in Russia, massive strikes all over Petrograd and other places. But the revolutionary organization was made of little cells, tiny little cells of 10, 5, 15. The average age of the cell, in other words, how long it took to the cell to be crippled by police raid, it was calculated at the time, it took 3 months for a police, for a group, for a party cell to disintegrate. Because on the average, every 3 months, the cell will be smashed. Every 3 months, it doesn't mean that everybody in the group was arrested. One will be arrested, the connection will break down. And therefore, in 1902, the emphasis of Lenin, if you read what is to be done very carefully, the emphasis of Lenin is a very simple one. How can we get those cells, those clubs, or those groups together to keep the continuity? And he says, in order to keep the continuity, the emphasis is on centralism. To emphasize must be on really specialists. The emphasis is on professionals, on people that know how to fight the police. Numbers doesn't count, because if you increase the number, you increase the risk. And therefore it is much more important to keep it very tight, very strong, even very, very small. Now in 1905, with the rising of the Russian Revolution, the attitude of Lenin is exactly the opposite. He writes, we have only 6,000 members in Petrograd. There are 80,000 workers in big factories in Petrograd. That's scandalous. We have to increase the party 5 times, 10 times over. And you say, I don't understand. What is Lenin saying? He said something in 1903 or 1902. He said something else in 1905. Now, of course, Lenin himself said in 1903, I bent the stick too far because the economists bent the stick the other direction. Now, many people mean that Lenin confessed to a mistake. It is nothing of the sort. Lenin always bent the stick too far. If you look at all his history, you'll find in every situation he bent the stick too far because he looks at the central danger. And where the central danger is, he says, let's fight it. And when in 1903 the central danger was a very simple one, that those myths, the group will disintegrate under police raid, under the local pressures, etc. In 1905 there was that danger was that the conservative elements inside the Marxists will come and say, men, we survived very well with 5,000 members or 6,000 members. Who the hell is in a rush to open the gates? And therefore you find Lenin always, because the center of Lenin's analysis was the agency of the working class. Every time his tactics are really dependent on the specific situation of the working class. And that's the reason why when you look at the history of Leninism, it is that people will say it is a history of opportunist zigzags. I say nothing of the sort. It is a history of zigzags in which the center of every zigzag was the interest and the